Good morning. Today is September 19th, Bible Study Guide number 3. Today our lesson is Glorifying God. Bible background will come from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52, Luke chapter 18, verses 35 through 43. Our print text is Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52, and our devotional reading will come from James chapter 5, verse 13 through 18. Our aim for change is, by the end of the lesson, we will compare and contrast spiritual and physical blindness, application, how God is attentive in response to our needs, and practice reaching out to those who are marginalized by society. Today I bring you from James chapter 5, verse 13 through 18. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing songs. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, or anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up, and if he have committed sins, they shall be forgiven. Confess your faults one to another, and pray for one another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of the righteous man availeth much. Elias was a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth. By the space of 3 years and 6 months, and he prayed again, and the heavens gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruits. I read from James chapter 5, verse 13 through 18. At this time, I'll give you James Conner, Minister James Conner.
Praise the Lord, everyone. Truly indeed, God is good. Give him praise and thanks for him allowing us to be here today. Let us go before the Lord and have a word of prayer. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning just give you thanks and praise for your mercy and grace. Heavenly Father, we praise you and thank you, Father. You continually blessed and been with us, O Lord. Father God, we pray upon this day, Father, as we go into this Sunday school lesson, God, that you give us understanding, open our minds and hearts. And God, that all that we teach and all that we learn, O Heavenly Father, be edification unto your name. Father God, we praise you and we thank you for it all now. We ask you to look over those that are sick and shed in, look over those that are bereaved upon this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Truly indeed, we have a wonderful lesson in store this morning, and thanking and praising God for just allowing us to wake and see another day. Just allowing us to wake and see another day. This morning, this is one of those lessons that you kind of wish you had a room full of Sunday school students this morning, just to get the to get that feedback and to hear what the students would have to say this morning. But regardless of, we have you all that are viewing us live. We have you all that are viewing us live, and it is definitely a great Sunday school lesson that we have in store this morning. Just looking at what the Lord is doing for us and how things are, you know, many things are going on in our society and how God is continually blessing and moving on our behalf. And so this morning, as we look into the lesson, we're talking about Bartimaeus and talking about glorifying God, coming from Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. I'm trying to get my phone so I can keep up with my time in here. But Mark chapter 10, verse 46 through 52. And so as we look at this lesson here this morning, get it pulled back up here, there we go. And as we look at this lesson this morning, it is gonna be a great lesson. And so this morning we're looking at Bartimaeus. And it says here in our Bible background, it tells us that in a sense, Bartimaeus' blindness is a metaphor that can be applied to all of chapter 10. Here in Mark. And so in the discussion of divorce, we look at chapter 10 verses 1 through 12. The Pharisees and the disciples were blind to God's view of the importance of family. Also, when we look into this chapter in 10 verses 13 through 16, it tells us that the disciples, that they were blind to the significance of children. Then also in chapter 10, verse 17 through 31, it says that the rich young ruler and the disciples were blind to the importance of the kingdom. So we see a lot of blindness going on here. And then also in chapter 10, verse 32 through 34, the disciples, they were blind to the meaning of Christ's suffering, both his death and his resurrection. So we have the Pharisees that are blind to the importance of family, the disciples that are blind to the importance, the significance of children, the rich young ruler and the disciples are blind to the kingdom. And then the disciples were also blind to the meaning of Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection. So in chapter 10, we see a whole lot of blindness going on here. Whole lot of blindness. And so immediately before Bartimaeus' account, the disciples again display their blindness and their desire, get this, for supremacy in the kingdom of God. Look at Mark 10, 35 through 45. So, the healing of Bartimaeus' blindness is a fitting close to this whole chapter on blindness. And so the healing of Bartimaeus' sight occurs during the last 3 months of Jesus' ministry, between the festival of dedication and his arrival in Jerusalem for the Passover. So, Jesus' reputation had been firmly established by this time when we see it, when we're looking at this here in these scriptures. But as we get started this morning, I want to ask you a question. In what ways is spiritual blindness like physical blindness? And where does spiritual blindness leave you? In what ways is spiritual blindness like physical blindness? In what ways is spiritual blindness like physical blindness? When we look at physical blindness, you know, we can't see. We can't see. Everything is dark, what have you. So your eyes cannot visualize, cannot see things that are in front of you. You can't see your surroundings. So you're physically blind. Now, when you look at spiritual blindness, what is spiritual blindness? Of course, you can't see things of the spirit, but also, yeah. Say what, bro? Yeah. I mean, yep, spiritual is. I mean, and you're right there. I mean, but when you look at spiritual blindness, it's so many of us walking around today that are spiritually blind. You know, we spiritually blind. We don't comprehend the things of the spirit. We don't understand the things of the spirit. And goodness, we don't live the things of the spirit. I mean, we just spiritually blind. And see, it's fascinating when you look at spiritual blindness and physical blindness, and you see so many ways that they are alike. Spiritually, you're not aware. You're not aware of the things around you, spirit-wise. You're not studying your word. You're not having that prayer time with the Lord. You don't have that relationship with the Lord. So you're spiritually blind. And in essence, you're just going along with the waves of the world. However the waves go, that's the way you go. And see, being having spiritual sight, you don't go along with the ways of the world. You go against those trends. You go against those things. But see, spiritual blindness is much like physical blindness. But where does spiritual blindness leave you? Where does it leave you? Destruction, death. Where does it leave you? See, you can be physically blind. Now, and this is what's so interesting, Brother Foe. You can be spiritually, you can be physically blind, and guess what happens? Your other senses heighten themselves to help you compensate and still live. And you can be physically blind. But now let's look at spiritual blindness. It ain't nothing there to compensate spiritual blindness. It ain't nothing there to heighten your senses on spiritual blindness. You can go through this world spiritually blind, but guess what happens in the end? You die. And where do you end up at? See, it's nothing to save you from that. And so your senses are not heightened. You don't have no way out because one part of your body is not functioning right. So there is no, let me put it to you plain. There is no other heaven. There's only one heaven. And there's only one hell. And you only going to one or the other. So if you're spiritually blind, well, guess what's going to happen? You're only going to one or the other. And the one you think you want to go to ain't the one you're going to be going to. So let's move on. I'm going to stop picking at y'all with that question there. I got another one for you. And I'm going to get a little bit more into this. So faith uses available resources. Man, faith uses available resources. Mark 10, 46 and 47. Look what it says here. It says, and they came to Jericho, and as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Faith uses what? Available resources. Jesus and his disciples, they're walking along the highway. And as they walked along the road, a man named Bartimaeus was blind, was sitting there, and he was begging for money. Now, in Bartimaeus' day, blindness represented that you had sinned and you were cursed by God. Now, get that. In that day, blindness represented that you had sinned and you were cursed by God. Physical blindness. Now, I wonder what some of y'all think about spiritual blindness when you read that. Jesus restoring sight to the blind is contrary to this belief. Thank the Lord for saving us. Three of the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, tell a narrative of blind man, and Jesus and the blind man's healing. So Mark, but Mark is the only writer that identifies this man by name. Now scholars have noted that Bartimaeus' name is a combination of Greek and Aramaic. So his father's name, Timaeus, is Greek. Now look at his name now, meaning honorable or worthy. Honorable or worthy. And the added prefix bar, meaning son. So Bartimaeus' name means son that is honorable or worthy. Now ain't that something? But in his day and time, blindness represented sin and that you were cursed by God. But his name means son, honorable, or worthy. So the combination of a Greek name with an Aramaic prefix is not found anywhere else in the Bible. So Bartimaeus is sitting by the highway, begging for money, and according to some scholars, he was known in the community because look what comes before this. The article, the son of Timaeus. So highlights that he's a recognized person. So he's known in the community. But what I'm getting at is just think about that drug addict, that drunkard in the neighborhood that you know. The son. So Bartimaeus' status as a blind and begging man, it was not unusual though. But what makes him different is his future actions and how others respond. And we're going to look at his future actions here. So Bartimaeus does not know who is walking in his direction until he hears what? Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus' popularity had grown because of his healing, teaching, and showing compassion on many. And so they believed in him. But Bartimaeus, he could not see. But get this, he could hear. Going back to physical blindness. He couldn't see, but he could hear. So he used what? His ears. He could not see, but he could think. So he used his brain to recall Jesus' reputation. He done heard about Jesus, so he used his brain to recall Jesus' reputation. But now also he could not see, but he could use his voice. So he cried out loudly, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. So get this, he couldn't see, but he could hear. He couldn't see, but he could think. He couldn't see, but he could use his voice. Faith uses available resources. So the available resources he had, he couldn't see, but he could think, he could hear, and he could use his voice. And he cried out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. So Bartimaeus, he believed that Jesus could change his life if he gave him his sight. So he cries out to Jesus. He does not weep with tears. And see, this is what some of us do. We want to cry out to Jesus. But hold on, Brother Pope, but this is what we do. We want to cry. We want to whimper. We want to worry. We want to do all this other stuff. And then we're trying to cry out to Jesus. But Bartimaeus, he shouts out loud to Jesus. And he addresses him using the title, Son of David, as he asks for mercy and healing. Now get this, Son of David. It indicates Jesus' royal lineage of David. The title also qualifies David, Jesus, as the ruler, as the Messiah. So Bartimaeus, he is clear that Jesus is the Messiah who can radically change his life. Do we address Jesus as the Messiah who can radically change our lives? Do we do that? Maybe some of y'all ain't feeling it yet, Brother Pope. Maybe they ain't feeling it yet. So I'm going to hit them with something else here in a minute. Hold on a minute. Hold on a minute. Here we go. Hold on a minute. Faith answers objections. Mark 10, 48 through 50. Now on this here, I'm going to need my media team. Mark 10, 48 through 50. Let's look at what it says right quick, because I'm getting a little excited here. I don't know if y'all can tell, but I'm getting a little excited here. So I'm trying to slow down a minute, It says that many charged him that he should hold his peace. Shut up, be quiet. But he cried out the more a great deal, "Thou son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, now get this. Now look at this. "Be of good comfort. Rise. He calleth you." Let me slow down. "And he, casting away his garment, rose and came to Jesus." Now wait a minute now. Faith answers objections. Faith answers objections. Many people standing near Bartimaeus wanted him to hold his peace. Shut up. Shh, be quiet. The more they told him to keep quiet and stop talking, the louder and more insistent he became. He refused to stop shouting for Jesus. Now get this. But Brother Paul, I'm going to need you here for a minute. Come here a minute. I'm going to need you here a minute. All right. Now get this. This is blind man. Mm-hmm. He heard, physical senses. He heard Jesus of Nazareth is coming down the road. It's a whole lot of folks. It's a whole lot of noise. It's a lot of folks there. And Jesus is in the midst. And this blind man, physically blind, now this is what makes us look bad. He physically blind, but wait a minute. He ain't spiritually blind, because he knows in his spirit, according to his faith, Jesus can heal me. I just believe I call out to him and he come. He can return my sight and I can see again. So here he is spiritually, here he is physically blind, and he's calling out, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me." Now see, that's why I wish I had a whole lot of folks in here this morning. Because see, then what I was going to do, what I was going to portray here was, I'm going to have everybody talking. I'm going to have everybody talking. So Brother Paul, I need you talking loud right now. Just make some noise. Zan, Lil J, just make some noise. So here he is, "Jesus, thy son of David, have mercy on me." And he keeps on crying out. They say, "Hush, hush, hush, be quiet. Jesus, thy son of David, have mercy on me." Do y'all see what I'm getting at here? Regardless of the noise, regardless of all the other distractions, he still cried out loud to Jesus. Why? Because he knew he needed a healing. And nothing was going to stop him from getting the healing that he needed. So he cried out. He cried out loud. "Shh, be quiet. Hush, hush. We trying to do it. Be quiet, be quiet. Sit down somewhere. I need Jesus to heal me." So regardless of your haters, regardless of folk telling you to be quiet, if you know you need something from Jesus, you cry out. And if they tell you to be quiet, you cry out louder. And so what he does is he cries out. Now get this. In all the noise, with all the noise, all the people, all the hustling and bustling, Bartimaeus shows us how we should boldly come before God with our requests, without fear of being ignored or being mocked. Because Christ always has time for us. He always has time for us. And see, Bartimaeus, he also reminds us that when we want to have a deeper relationship with Jesus, we should give all of who we are. He was not worried about, now wait a minute. See, y'all gonna laugh because he was blind. Some of us can see. I think some of us need to be blind. Because see, Bartimaeus, he wasn't worried about how he looked. He wasn't worried about how his hair was. He wasn't worried about his clothes or nothing else. He needed Jesus. If it took him getting on his knees, he was going to get on his knees. See, some of us, we so pretty, we don't want to get on our knees. We don't want to wrinkle our clothes. We don't want to look like we're crying and getting snotty nose and all this stuff. Bartimaeus reminds us, if we want to have a deeper relationship with Jesus, we got to give him all of who we are. Mm-hmm. Giving up on getting to Jesus was not a part of his plan. Crying out to Jesus, acknowledging his presence in the situation, meant something better than what he was experiencing had to happen. He believed that Jesus could offer him something better than what he was going through. But get this. Jesus, thy son of David, have mercy on me. Out of all the people, out of all the noise, out of all the hustling and moving and everything going on, look what happens. He's hollering for Jesus. Think about if you at a concert and you hollering for Jesus, all this noise going on, and get this, Jesus heard it. Calling for him, and Jesus stopped walking. Now, I know some of y'all know about the woman with the issue of blood in the crowd, and she came through the crowd, and she did what? She touched the hem of his garment. And Jesus said, because of her faith, who done touched me? Now, get that now. Jesus in the crowd, y'all. Deacon Randall, he going through this crowd. There's a whole lot of folks probably touching him. But see, this is what messes us up. How many of us cry out to Jesus in faith? And how many of us, like the one with the issue of blood, touch Jesus in faith? See, it's a whole lot of y'all. See, this is where I'm going with this. See, it's a whole lot of y'all coming to church. But y'all coming to church for the wrong reasons. So y'all ain't coming to church for Jesus. Y'all coming here for Pastor Mabry. Y'all coming here for Reverend Connor to teach Sunday school. Look, we ain't all that in a bag of chips now. We just the Lord's servants. Teaching and preaching the Lord's word. Don't come here for Pastor Mabry. Don't come here for Reverend Connor. Whoever you going to church for. It ain't about us. You need to come here for Jesus. Because, see, if you come here for Jesus, you're going to get exactly what you need. Because right. I can guarantee you, and I can speak for my pastor on this one, we ain't paying your bills. No. We can't heal you. We can't do none of that. But if you go to the man that can, if you go to Jesus Christ who can do all this stuff, oh, you can get it done. Because, see, me and Pastor May, we might have an issue with you. Because we just human just like you are. You done us dirty. We might not be turned the other cheek yet. Because on some stuff, I ain't turned the other cheek. I'm just being real. Jesus, look, the Lord ain't through with me yet. But see, with Jesus, Lord, with Jesus, see, if you come to him in faith, he can heal you. He can deliver you. He can save you. He can bring you out. So all I'm saying is don't depend on man. See, don't come to church because of man. You need to come to church because of Jesus. So, out of all the noise, y'all excuse me for that ramp there, but of all the noise, Jesus hears Bartimaeus pleading for help despite all the noise, the people and the activity that was happening. Jesus wanted to see him. Spiritual blindness, physical blindness, and faith, Bartimaeus called out. Spiritually, Bartimaeus called out. Spiritually, Bartimaeus could see. Physically, Bartimaeus was blind. Spiritually, Jesus heard him. Jesus said, see, y'all got to get this. Jesus said, I want to see him. I hear him crying out spiritually. I want to physically see this man now. And because I want to physically see him, because he spiritually sees me and wants me and has faith in me, now I'm physically going to give him sight. See, I don't think y'all got that. And he wanted everybody else to witness it. So based on text, Bartimaeus, he didn't have family or friends to help him. See, some of y'all want to sit around here and wait on your family folks and your friends to help you get to the Lord. Man, you better leave that alone. If you want to get to the Lord, you better come on, get to him yourself. He was again, but look at this now. He was again dependent upon the people around him to get him to Jesus. Now look at this. The same people, Brother Ron, that told him to hush and be quiet,
right,
had to help him get to Jesus. Jesus said, bring him to me. The people who were just telling him to be quiet about his bold shouts are now telling him to be bold and approach Jesus. Bartimaeus' determination to call out to Jesus had paid off. He throws off his garment, jumped to his feet, and went directly to Jesus. He didn't procrastinate on going to Jesus. Now I'm finna bust some bubbles. Y'all just gonna have to, y'all gonna be mad at me this morning, so you just gonna have to forgive me.
Tell us the truth.
See, Bartimaeus, I want to deal with this garment for a minute, Brother Paul.
All right.
Bartimaeus, he throws off his garment. It got me when I studied this last night about this garment. And the Lord just gave me a message on this. Just now. Bartimaeus throws off his garment. See, I want to ask a question before I get to my other question. How many of y'all are willing to throw off your garment and come directly to Jesus without procrastinating? What do I mean by this garment? How many of y'all are willing to stop sleeping around with Johnny, Susie, Mabry? How many of y'all are willing to stop sleeping around, tipping and creeping? How many of y'all are willing to stop drinking, smoking, doing all these other things you're doing? How many of y'all are willing to put down all your hellish ways and come on to Jesus and stop procrastinating? Because many of y'all sitting out there right now, I just can't stop creeping. I can't stop sleeping with her. I can't stop drinking. I can't stop doing this. I can't stop going to the casino. I just got to do it. It just make me feel good. The sexual feeling that I get, I just got to keep doing it. How many of y'all can stop doing that mess and come to Jesus and stop procrastinating? Because that's all many of us are doing. We just procrastinate.
Yeah.
We coming up with all kind of excuses. I ain't ready yet. You been ready. Are you ready to go to hell? I mean, that's basically what you're saying. I ain't ready to come to Jesus, but I'm ready to go to hell. I'm ready to bust hell wide open. Just slide down a sliding board full of razor blades and alcohol. I'm just ready to go. How many of you are ready to throw down those old, dirty, sinful garments and jump on your feet and come directly to Jesus and stop procrastinating? Because that's all many of us are doing. We just procrastinating. We got such attitudes. We got such crazy ways. And then we got the audacity to say, Jesus knows my heart. Jesus knew Bartimaeus' heart also.
Yeah.
Bartimaeus was physically blind, but he spiritually could see. And he spiritually cried out to Jesus, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Some of us didn't even plead for some mercy. Stop praying for cars and houses and all this stuff. You need to ask for some mercy.
Yes.
You need to ask for some mercy. But he cried out for mercy. And because he was physically blind, but he could spiritually see that he needed help. He needed deliverance. He could spiritually see that Jesus was the way. And Jesus wanted to physically see him, the person that was spiritually calling out to him, so that he could give him sight. Question. Bartimaeus, he boldly ignored the crowd and sought Jesus. How do you do this in your life today? He boldly ignored the crowd. See, I know y'all feel all good fitting in the clique and being like this group and all that stuff. You know, I told my 17-year-old son, he plays football, Lil' Jay, well, James Conner II to be proper. He plays football, but I told my son, you ain't a part of the crowd. You can't be like the crowd. You can't fit in with the crowd. Because you got to look back to what the Lord done did with you from your birth. You can't fit in with everybody. So you separated. You was marked, and I'm saying it, you was marked when you were born. So because you were marked when you were born, dedicated to Christ, and Christ healed you, you ain't fitting in. See, there are some of us, we trying to fit in with folks, and we trying to be a part of this group. And you just like you just sticking out like a sore thumb. You don't even fit in. Why keep trying to fit in with a bunch of folks that ain't going nowhere, that ain't got nothing going for themselves, that are just sitting here living like the world, being like the world, and acceptable to everything in the world? And the Lord is sitting here tugging on you. Come to me. Follow me. Don't go there. Don't do that. Remember what your mom and daddy told you? Just sitting there tugging on you. Just trying to tell you, come this way. And your parents are trying to teach you the right way to go, the right way to do things. And the Lord is just sitting there waiting on you to come. But you keep trying to fit in with folks. See, Bartimaeus, he didn't fit in. He was already blind physically. So folks already thought he had sinned. Folks already thought he was cursed, so he wasn't fitting in with nothing. There are some folks out there looking at you like you already cursed, you know, and you sitting there trying to fit in. You sitting there spending money that you can be spending money on something else, trying to fit in with these folks, sitting here almost broke, and then they still don't want to fool with you. Why are you wasting your time? So see, Bartimaeus, he boldly ignored the crowd, regardless of what they were saying, regardless of how much they told him to hush, he still cried out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. So how do you do this in your life today? You need to do it the same way Bartimaeus did. You need to ignore the crowd. You need to ignore the folks around you. Because you know what you need. And I can boldly say, you know that the Lord can give it to you. So why are you wasting your time? Let me put it like this. Why are you wasting your time with peasants when you can be sitting over here at the table with the king? Move. You got to move. You got to cry out to the Lord that who can deliver you, who can bring you out, who can heal you. And if you get the mercy, see, Bartimaeus cried out first for mercy. Because, see, here's the thing about mercy. And I'm going to go over this again. Mercy is all you need. Because along with mercy, Jesus is going to handle everything else. You don't have to sit here and cry out for money and cars and all this stuff. Ask for mercy. Because with the mercy, he's going to take care of everything else. And Lord knows I need his mercy. I'm probably going to need his mercy after this Sunday school lesson, because ain't no telling what some of y'all going to be going to put on our Facebook post. But faith makes specific requests. Faith makes specific requests. Verse 51 and 52, it says, and Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? And look at what the blind man said. Look at what blind Bartimaeus says. Lord, that I might receive my sight. Faith makes specific requests. And Jesus said unto him, go thy way. Thy faith had made thee whole. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. Jesus asked Bartimaeus, what do you want me to do? He already knows. See, for y'all talking about Jesus knows my heart. Look, he already knows what Bartimaeus deeply desires and needs. He is the omniscient God. Jesus would sometime ask us questions of people to reveal the truth of what they wanted or their thoughts. When we want Jesus' attention, we should not scream about our virtues, talents, resources, or assets. Ask him for mercy. If he gives you mercy, as he certainly will, he will surely give you everything that goes along with it. All you gotta do is ask for mercy. So the questions and our answers are prompts us to trust and talk to Jesus in our most valuable, vulnerable states. We say Jesus knows our heart. Jesus asks him, what do you want me to do? Jesus already knows what you need. But see, here's what I'm getting at here. Jesus knows what we need. But see, this is where we mess up at. We don't ask Jesus for what we need. See, I pull this one with my kids, with my young adults now. I pull this with them. See, mom and daddy know what you need, Brother Paul. We know what you need. Yeah. And see, we ask you, well, what you want, son? What you want? See, Brother Paul, you need a pair of shoes. You need some good shoes. That's what you need. But see, here's where we mess up. See, I hope y'all listen. See, here's where we mess up. You need a pair of shoes. But you want a pair of Nikes. Yeah. Follow me now. You need a pair of shoes. Yeah. But you want a pair of Nikes. Now, is Nikes really what you need? See, you need mercy. Now, Bartimaeus, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Bartimaeus asked for what he needed. He asked specific. See, faith asks for specifics. See, he asked specifically, I want my sight. I won't be able to see. I don't want no shades. I won't be able to see. See, he could have said, give me some shades to cover up my blindness. I want to be able to see. I don't want no bifocals. I don't want no shade. I want to be able to see. You need a pair of shoes, but you want a pair of Nikes. So, mom and daddy, just like Jesus, we're going to get you a pair of shoes. So what does mom and daddy do? Do we buy you a $50 pair of shoes? Or do we buy you $175, $5 pair of Nikes? No, mom and daddy gonna buy you a $50 pair of shoes. Cause what? That's what you need. But you want a pair of Nikes. So guess what's gonna happen? You gonna get them $50 pair of shoes. And when you take care of these $50 pair of shoes, when you show yourself worthy of these $50 pair of shoes, guess what? One day we might look at getting you a pair of Nikes.
Right.
But first, you're going to be faithful with what? I'm trying to teach y'all something here. You're going to be faithful with these $50 pair of shoes. Now, if you can be faithful with this, I'll add some more on to it. Be specific with your request. The question and our answers are prompts to trust and talk to Jesus in our most vulnerable states. When you're at your weakest, when you're at your most vulnerable, be specific about what you're asking the Lord for. Bartimaeus answers Jesus' question by stating he wants to see. Jesus first responds by giving a direct action to go. See, that didn't take long. See, I'm trying to tell y'all something here. See, when you ask Jesus for something, Jesus asks you a question back. What do you want me to do? What do you want from me? You got to be specific. And when you are on point and ask Jesus for exactly for what you know you need, it don't take, see, some of y'all saying, you wonder why it's taking so long for your prayer to get answered. Maybe you ain't asking for the right thing. Jesus fulfills a request immediately and tells him to go. Go your way. Then he tells Bartimaeus, your faith has healed you. His eyes are open. And his vision is what? See, Jesus don't halfway do no blessing. See, some of y'all sitting here thinking, Lord, the Lord done bless me. Lord done bless me. And you sitting up worried at night about how you going to pay a car note. See, Lord done bless you. Because see, when Jesus blesses, he blesses wholly and perfectly. Bartimaeus got vision, and he had what? Perfect vision. It wasn't no 50-50. It was 100-100. It was perfect vision. So Bartimaeus, but get this, he does not walk away or run to the nearest temple. Instead, he walks with Jesus along the road. So all I'm saying here is, when Jesus blesses some of us, see, some of us have this tendency, we want to run out and just go on and get all high-minded and show our tails and all this other stuff. Instead, we need to walk with the Lord. See, Bartimaeus, he didn't run out and go do nothing else. He went right along the roadside with Jesus. He didn't run off nowhere else. He walks with Jesus along the road. We have been blessed, but too many of us are not walking with Jesus. We don't travel down another road. We need to walk on the road with Jesus. When we cannot see the end of whatever we are going through, we need to believe that Jesus is with us. And so Bartimaeus, he's a guy that sometimes we have to wait for Jesus to respond to our questions and our concerns. And when Jesus does answer, we should be prepared to say or do what we want in faith and continue following Jesus. Yes. We ask for it. Jesus blesses us. Now we need to continue to follow him in faith because the world is looking at us. But I want to ask you a heart-piercing question here. Do you follow Jesus out of gratitude for what he has done or merely out of religious obligation? Do you follow Jesus out of gratitude for what he has done for you? You know he done healed you. You know he done delivered you. Whether you were healed from cancer, drugs, whatever, you know that Jesus did this for you. Do you follow him out of gratitude? Or do you follow him out of merely religious obligation? I'm just a Sunday school teacher. Pastor Mabry is just a pastor. Deacon Run is just a deacon. Now, if you're going to follow St. Paul just out of religious obligation, Pastor Mabry might sit here and say today, St. Paul, it's been a pleasure. Love y'all. I'm out. Y'all might look and say, well, Reverend Connor going to be the next pastor. St. Paul, I love y'all, but Pastor Mabry leaving, I'm out. Now you down to the deacon. Deacon running. St. Paul, guess we gonna have to we gonna have to pray. Are you following Jesus? Follow what I'm saying now. Now me and Pastor Mabry ain't going nowhere. Get that out your head. But what I'm saying now, are you following Jesus because of gratitude out of what he has done for you? Or are you following him out of religious obligation? See, religious obligation is fickle. It changes. It's up here 1 minute, down here next minute. 1 minute you feel like going to church, next minute you don't feel like going to church. See, some of y'all don't feel like coming to church, you don't come to church. Me and Pastor May, we here at church. Hey, we know what the Lord done for us. We here regardless. See, are you following Jesus because of what he has done for you out of gratitude, or are you following him out of religious obligation? Is Christianity just the easy path for you? Or do you follow it with purpose? See, is Christianity an easy path? Or do you follow it with purpose? See, some of us, with our tongues, we say Jesus, but our hearts say the devil. I hope y'all follow what I'm saying there. Some of us say Jesus, but we some hell raisers when it comes to our heart. Because, see, our heart ain't following Jesus. Our mouth is. So some of us just have a form of godliness, but goodness, our hearts, they on the other side of town. Is Christianity an easy path for you, or do you follow it with purpose? Simply meaning, when you know you done somebody wrong, do you come back and apologize? Do you come back and say, forgive me, I was wrong? Or do you just say, the H with them? Forget it. Y'all know what I'm saying. Christianity should not be an easy path. We should follow it with purpose. As I close this morning, how do we as the church uplift those in the margins? And when we talk about those in the margin, we're talking about those that are marginalized, those that are undervalued, those that are underappreciated. See, so that they can know the love and power of God. So let us seek to introduce people with both physical and spiritual challenges to Jesus. For Jesus says, now I want y'all to hear this, Jesus says, those who have been what? Forgiven much, love much. You know what you done been forgiven for. So if you have been forgiven much, and all of us sitting in here saying, Jesus, 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 we done been forgiven much. Simply, we need to love much. If you done been forgiven much, you need to love much. Sunday, the next lesson for next Sunday. Believers praise God. Bible background, Acts chapter 2, 32-33, 37-47. Printed text, the same. And our devotional reading become from Psalms 134. And so our aim for change will be we will understand the role of Christ and the Holy Spirit in our lives, discern how the Holy Spirit inspires believers to share a life of worship, and plan opportunities for people to begin a relationship with Jesus through our ministries. But I pray this lesson this morning, I hope it opened up your mind as we glorify God. So I pray that this message, this Sunday school lesson was inspiring. I hope that it would invoke change in your lives. But we all have to be who Christ has called us to be. And we all have to glorify God because he has done so much for us. May God bless you. May God keep you is our prayers. All right.